Vatican newspaper, which made news because he was saying that in his opinion, there is a certain possibility now of intelligent life elsewhere in the universe, and that the discovery of that would not challenge the authority of the church or the doctrine of the church or the faith of the church. And those statements by Funes, they were just the most recent in a whole string of comments, really, over the last few years by Vatican astronomers, confirming a belief that discovery may be made in the very near future of alien life. And when we say alien life, not just organisms, if you will, like the current lander on Mars is digging, and as I understand it, there's information we haven't received yet about the possibility of life on Mars. But when the Vatican talks about these issues, they're talking about intelligent life, advanced intelligent life, and that discovery would not unhinge the doctrine of Christ. Now, I actually remember in 2005, Vatican astronomer Guy Cosmonaugo, you know, he tackled that subject in his 50-page booklet, Intelligent Life in the Universe. And he concluded the same thing, that the chances now are better than not that mankind is facing a future discovery of extraterrestrial intelligence. And then as far as the Vatican is concerned, 7 years before that, you know, you had Monsignor Corrado Balducci.
Mm-hmm.
And he also made news when he went so far as to say that not only was the possibility of ET there, but that they were already interacting with Earth, and that some of the Vatican's leaders were aware of it. And of course, you know, coast to coast, who can forget Father Malachi Martin?
Oh, exactly.
You know, exactly. Talking about the Vatican, and he was doing this back in the mid '90s. That the reason why the Vatican had its advanced technology telescope, the VAT project there at Mount Graham International Observatory in Arizona, was because the Vatican knew at the highest levels what was going on in deep space and what was approaching us. And that was the comment on the coast to coast, you know, that caught so many of us, and that it would be of great importance.
Does it appear to you that these visitations, either coming through stargates, portals, or wherever, are slowing down or picking up?
Well, they're certainly not slowing down. I mean, right now, in the last year, it's been difficult almost to keep up with the news. And it's been on Coast to Coast. It's been on Larry King Live. It's been on CNN. It's been on all of the or most of the major networks. And from what I understand, researchers are telling us now that we are probably in the greatest UFO flap in history. So it's certainly not slowing down. It's picking up. And then the question, of course, is it accelerating towards something?
Uh-huh.
So, and as far as the Vatican officials, to me, the question has been, if ET life is something that these officials have been considering for some time, why are they also talking so much about it openly now, in just the last few years? You know, why are they coming out on the forefront?
Do you think disclosure's coming? Because I don't, Tom. I don't think governments will tell us.
Well, here's one key issue, George. What if they don't have an option? See,
it's got to be pretty obvious then.
Huh?
It's got to be pretty darn obvious.
Well, but what if they don't have an option? What if they are put in a situation where they just only have so long? Then wouldn't it make sense that vehicles like the Vatican, because many of the government's studies have shown that disclosure of intelligence beyond Earth, even if this means that we're going to admit that we found artificial structures on Mars or whatever it might mean. You know, studies that were funded by the government early on showed that this might have a catastrophic effect on different things. The economy, people wouldn't want to spend their money if they saw giant UFOs hovering, you know, above the White House. They're not going to run out and buy a car, so it might have the effect of closing down the world's economies. The other question might be, how it might affect people's religious faith. But the most recent polls have shown that most people, and this is what's intriguing to me about the Vatican being out here on the forefront of this, whether information has been known for some time, and I've always been made to understand that when we start nearing disclosure, you would see the Vatican putting out, you know, what might be thought of as a careful unveiling over a 24 or 36 month period, a deliberate effort by church officials to warm up the laity to ET disclosure. And now, whether that's what's happening or not, I can't say, but official church publications on the subject have been coming forward in a steady stream now for 24 months. And is this, you know, an attempt to soften the blow before official disclosure in order to help the faithful retain their orthodoxy in light of what this unprecedented knowledge might represent? And if so, you know, is the government in league with this, and do they view it as being smart for the world's religious communities to dialogue the issue because of how it might impact many traditions spiritually? So, and then, of course, you also have people who say that this, all of this could be like a great deception, that we're being outwitted by some kind of malevolent force.
David Jacobs would say that. And very possible. What about 2012? Do you see any tie-ins between this and your work?
Well, yeah. And you know, we started out this show talking about David Flynn. And Flynn, he actually wrote a guest chapter in my book, the sixth chapter, actually, in my book on the year 2012. But throughout the book, you know, throughout that and beyond that, there is this idea that the gods of Middle America, the Aztecs, the Mayan deities, such as Quetzalcoatl in particular, that their mythology and the end of their long calendar might reflect or be an alternative version, if you will, of the return of the chief gods in 2012. And a lot of this corresponds with ancient Eastern prophecies about the return of the giants, which I was referring to a moment ago, and tying into what we're doing right now in Babylon with this Mayan belief. And the thing about the Mayans, you know, they're very hermetic in their use of symbolism. And I found it to be extraordinary that among the legends of these multi-dimensional spirit beings, you had this whole methodology that existed whereby they could at least in some cases move from beyond gateways through statues, persons. There, you know, there again, I go right back to these portals. The whole Mayan belief system is also part of this whole phenomenon. But they also refer to winged discs. In fact, one of the ideas behind Quetzalcoatl returning in 2012 is that he is going to descend in a winged disc along a certain heavenly sky location as he returns back into Earth's reality. And so you have this whole hermetic iconography, the beginning and ending points of the sky. You've heard all of this, position where the ecliptic, the pathway of the sun crosses the Milky Way, and the whole ancient descriptions depicting the distance between those the points as a snake called the Ouroboros, the tail devourer, encompassing the heavens and swallowing its tail. That's one of the oldest mystical symbols in the world, and it's in Aztec and Mayan, Chinese, Native American mythologies. But that this is a symbol of something being or entering the Ouroboros. This is actually illustrated on Aztec and Toltec ruins in regard to Quetzalcoatl.
Pictures of?
Yeah. Showing Quetzalcoatl. Sometimes he's actually shown as being the Ouroboros, but sometimes he's shown as descending from the sky on a rope ladder. You've probably seen those pictures.
Yeah, and we also have seen him sitting in some kind of machine-like.
That's right.
Yep.
That's right. But he's prophesied, according to some people and also the Mayan text to return in 2012.